Kaushik, Thiru Malachar, and Satyajit Nath. They are all experts on instrumentation and control systems, along with Kaushik, who was BTech in electrical and electronics engineering. And they are one of the integral parts of the technologies. And we have with us our academic chairperson in Professor Alok Kumar Borogohai with us this morning. Our Vice Chancellor, sir, will be joining us soon. And before I open the floor for the discussion this morning, I would like to welcome Professor Alok Kumar Borogohai, sir, who is the chairperson of academics. And he has had his early education in Shillong and was among the first batch of graduates. He's a first class first in botany from NEHU, that's the Northeastern Hill University, Shillong. And he obtained his post graduation from Guwahati University in botany. PhD from the Imperial College of Science and Technology and Medicine, London, in plant molecular biology under the University of London, and DIC in plant virology from Imperial College of Science, Technology and Medicine. He was the founder head of the Department of Molecular Biology and Biotechnology at Tejpur University, a central university in Assam. And Professor Borogohai is also the founder of the ONGC-sponsored Center for Petroleum Biotechnology at Tejpur University. Professor Borogohai has extensive experience of over four decades in research and teaching and has more than 80 research publications in international and national journals of repute. During the last 10 years, Professor Borogohai had stints in academic governance, first as the Registrar of Tejpur University and then as the Vice Chancellor of Dibrugarh University, Assam, for full terms of 5 years each in both the positions. Professor Borogohai has made remarkable contribution in forging industry academia interfacing and in bringing in international academic research collaboration at Dibrugarh University under the UKIERI, Indo-US and Indo-Indonesian research schemes. He was awarded for his remarkable contribution towards exemplary industry academia partnership by Worldwide Industry Academia Network. I would now request, at the very outset, I request Professor Alok Borogohai, sir, to place the welcome address in today's webinar. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Dikam. Am I audible?
You are audible, sir. Sir, we just can't see you visually.
You can see, you cannot see. I mean, I'm not visible. Am I right?
Yeah, you are not visible, sir.
We can because hear of the bandwidth. Because of the bandwidth, I checked it. So I think you have to bear with that. Thank you so much for your kind introduction.
Right, sir.
Our very distinguished speakers this morning, Madam Saila S. Nadgir, Mr. Satyajit Nath, Mr. Kaushik Thirumalachari, from the Fluke Technology Private Limited in Bangalore. I, on behalf of the Royal Global University in Guwahati, and also on my personal behalf, extend to all the speakers and all those who are participating in this webinar a very hearty welcome for a very interesting and exciting discussion ahead. This university is a relatively new university, very new university, I would say. It started as an institute about 19 years back, but then now it has transformed into a university by an act of the state legislature from 2000, I think 3 years back. And we have started a range of subjects from the graduate and postgraduate up to the PhD level. And we have a very good engineering institute as well, offering the BTech and Tech and PhD programs there. Now, this particular lecture series that we have started, this morning we are going to listen to from these three experts from Fluke Technologies Bangalore, is on basics of metrology and understanding importance of measurement and calibration concepts. This is being organized under the aegis of the Institution Innovation Council of Royal Global University, which has been established here, again, as a guideline, as a policy directive of the then Ministry of Human Resource Development and now Ministry of Education. So we are beginning activities under this innovation institution council. And as far as the topic is concerned, we look forward to the experts. It's a very interesting and very, very relevant topic, the metrology. I can only tell you as a researcher for last so many years that the very quality of research depends on reproducibility of the result. And for that, what we require is absolutely perfect, precise measurement technologies. Whatever machines, whatever equipment, whatever experiments we do using these machines and equipment, it is of critical importance that these are reproducible and there is no scope for any variation or variability in the results with respect to the measurements, with respect to the data that we derive out of our experimentation. The whole philosophy of the quality of research depends on how precise, how perfect we are in our measurement technologies, in what kind of standards we use as a reference point. Especially, this is a very tricky affair in biological experiments for the complexity and nature of the biological molecules which are to be used as standards. So, but it is being done, standardized, it has been optimized, and now we are comfortable in whatever standards we use for our biological experimentations. Very, very high precision technologies, standards have been set up. Now, metrology has got its own importance in the industrial sector for which is connected with, which is related to manufacturing. So it is absolutely important that we have absolutely precise methodologies and means for ensuring that our measurements are absolutely perfect. There should not be any scope for any variation or variability in our measurements. So we now know how the contentious issue of fixing the standard for the weight, a kilogram, which was based on a piece of physical object of, I think, tritium, iridium, platinum iridium, that was there, and it has been now done away with a more reliable amount to fix the actual value of a kilogram, the measurement. So in the with the coming of nanotechnology then and other precision science at the very micro level, the importance of metrology has is in great significance. And I understand from the speakers belonging to the manufacturing domain that our focus will be on the industrial importance of metrology in measurement and calibration concepts. And we look forward to a very brilliant discourse this morning. And I'm sure our students, our researchers, our young faculty should tremendously benefit from this. With these few words, may I request you to really proceed with your discussion. Over to Deepak. Thank you.
Thank you so very much, sir, for your welcome remarks. And before I request Shaila S. Nadgir to take over the discussion, I would like to give you all a brief introduction about her. Shaila S. Nadgir is a metrologist, and she is the product manager, electrical, with Fluke Technologies Private Limited, Bangalore, India. She is an electronic engineer with 32 years of experience in core metrology on various metrology fields like electrotechnical, temperature, pressure, mechanical, and RF instrumentation and others. She started her career in 1982 with ETDC Bangalore, a lab under STQC Directorate.
I missed the last part because of some technical problem, but then I can hear you again.
Sir, we are just giving out a brief about Madam Nadgir before she takes over the discussion. And it's a brief that I'm reading about her. She served as a laboratory head in various calibration labs of STQC at various locations in India for 23 years, and she was responsible for setting up of the calibration lab, including the lab design, and headed technical committee for instrumentation, procurements for the calibration labs, instrumental and key role in successfully establishing the calibration labs of various above disciplines as per the requirements of ISO IEC 17025. She was also a faculty for various metrology trainings. Presently, she is working as a product manager at Fluke India since May 2005, fully owned company of Fluke Corporation USA in India. Established in-house calibration labs like TTL, CAL labs across various locations in India in the field of electrical, pressure, temperature, and flow calibrations, and accredited to National Accreditation Board for Testing and Calibration Laboratories, NABL, as per ISO IEC 17025. She is an active faculty of Fluke Knowledge Center, a dedicated center in Bangalore, exclusively to train customers on instrumentation, core metrology topics. And she has a sharp domain skills and technical subject knowledge, hands-on workshops with real-life practical sessions. We welcome you, madam, to this webinar with Royal Liverpool University this morning. And before we start the discussions, I would request you to kindly address our attendees along with the faculty and our students this morning. Thank you, ma'am, and welcome to this webinar. Madam Nargir, can you hear me?
Yeah, very good morning, Mr. Dekom. This is Kaushik speaking.
Hi, hi.
Shaila is having some network issues, so she's trying to join back to this call. Meanwhile, I would like to introduce ourselves, and I would like to take the first session and waste the time and with the respect of the crowd. So,
Kaushik, you have 8 years. You are basically with the technical part of Fluke Technologies. You've been there with 8 long years. And before we then have madam, then we will start with you this morning, which means Kaushik. Then over to you, and all the very best. We are more than delighted to have all of you here this morning. And now let's hear from Kaushik Piru Malachar.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Dekom.
Yeah.
So a very good morning for each and every one of you who is a part of this webinar today for the basics of metrology and understanding the importance of measurement and calibration concept. I'm sure some of you would have heard the name Fluke. So Fluke is the company who is the master in the calibration and measurement instrument manufacturing. So the first session I'll be taking you through is what is Fluke and why is the name Fluke? And how is Fluke relevant to the industry of calibration and measurement? So followed by the agenda will be the introduction part of Fluke, followed by the electrical calibration concepts, which is a very, very interesting topic, which Madam Shaila will be driving this. And followed by the electrical concepts will be the pressure calibration concepts. It's yet another important topic to discuss, which will be taken care by Mr. Satyajit Nath. He will also be covering you the temperature concepts of the calibration. So once we are done with the electrical and temperature, I will be coming back again to talk to you more about how is the center of excellence which is being established across India, what Fluke has contributed to the education sector in establishing the center of excellence for the calibration industry. So with that, we will be concluding our webinar with the question and answer session. So can someone Kaushik, if my voice is audible?
Before you actually take the floor, Kaushik, this is Dekom once again. Can I
all
our participants to please keep your microphones in mute as to not disturb our experts in this webinar. I once again request all the participants in this webinar to kindly keep your microphones in mute so that we don't get any distractions while the webinar is on at this moment. Over to you, Kaushik. I'm sorry for this interruption. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dekom. So can you confirm if my screen is visible?
Yes, Kaushik.
Yeah, we are confirming that your screen is visible. All clear.
Okay, thank you very much. So yeah. I hope my voice is clear and loud, right?
Perfect.
Yeah, thank you very much. So as I was referring in the previous address, Fluke is the global market leader with a wide experience of 72 plus years in the innovation field of calibration technology. So the first particular product which was manufactured by Fluke was a power meter in 1948. The first instrument was shipped to General Electric Company, which was the pioneer in electrical manufacturing at 1948. So since 1948, the journey has evolved with Fluke in a lot of more innovation way. So as of now, in 2020, we are the leaders in calibration and testing equipment. So we started off with our production range in electrical products. We gradually added up temperature products. We gradually added up our pressure products. And today, Fluke calibration is there in each and every domain of the calibration and measurement technology. So I am sure most of you will be having a doubt. What is the name Fluke? Why is it Fluke? Because Fluke as such gives a different meaning in the English language. So the man which you can see on the right side of the screen, he is Mr. John Fluke Sr. So he is the founder of this company. He is the brain behind this particular brand. And this particular company was found in the basement of his residence. So in 1948, Mr. John Fluke has started this particular company in his basement of the residence. If you can see on the picture, that is the basement of his residence where the wattmeters were being manufactured in the first go. So in 1948, this man founded the company. And after this, the name of the company became Fluke Corporation, which came after him. So the first priority of Mr. John Fluke was the safety. So he emphasized the products on the safety aspects, on the quality aspect. And one thing which he always was emphasizing was the customer who are the user of the products should always get more than what they have paid for. So this is the brain which he had in manufacturing these particular products. And the quality and the ruggedness and the safety were built in accordance with this particular tagline. So I'll not take you more into our commercial profile because we want to have our technical discussions going on. So quickly, I'll take you through the global locations. So we have our operations in more than 72 locations throughout the world. We have our manufacturing locations in our Washington in Everett, followed by UK, which is in Norwich, Cambridge, and Oxford. We have a empty of manufacturing locations in Europe. And we have our manufacturing location in China and Japan and India also. So with this, I'll be introducing you our parent company. So Fluke is a part of a bigger company, which is called as a Fortive Corporation. So Fortive Corporation is a 40,000 crore revenue company, which is having around 28,000 employees. So you will be coming across various aspects of interactions in your day-to-day activities. So each and every thing which you come across in your life is a part of Fortive company. For example, Tektronix. I'm sure you would have handled some oscilloscopes, some function generators, some the manufacturing equipments in electronic industries. So that has been manufactured by Tektronix, which is yet again an operating company of Fortive. So you would have seen these petrol vending machines, right? So that is manufactured by a company which is yet again a Fortive company. So we have around 35 operating companies within Fortive. So the companies which you are seeing on the screen is relevant for the field solution and for the product which is pertaining to the measurement equipment. So now if we come into the Fluke, so Fluke has got four different aspects inside its own portfolio. So the Fluke process instruments. Fluke process instrument is pertaining to the process industries, which has been operating and which is also using the Fluke calibration products. So Fluke process instrument, Fluke calibration, and Fluke biomedicals. Fluke biomedical is one of the unique segment which is catering to the health segment. So Fluke biomedical is one of the part of Fluke, and Fluke network. So all these network related product like land testers and all, will be a part of the Fluke network product. So this particular slide is just a snapshot of the first slide, which we saw. In 1948, the Fluke, John Fluke started this particular company in his basement, and it was all the way it is innovation till 2020. There is no look back in any of the year where we have not innovated. If you can see, every year or every other year, we are innovating some or the other products. So Fluke is nothing but the whole bunch of innovation and the innovative products for the further future generation. I'll just give you a brief of Fluke calibration. Fluke calibration is a leader in manufacturing of precision calibration equipment. We have a wide range of products with us, starting from electrical calibration, temperature calibration, pressure and flow calibration. We have radio frequency calibration, and we have integrated calibration solution to integrate all this calibration and put it on a test bench or a calibration bench, which we'll be talking in detail about all these products in our upcoming slides. So we have our distribution in India across all states and all major cities. We have our channel partners or our distributors for your immediate assistance nearby you. So we are a unique service solution provider. It is not like some other company where we do only sales and services. We also do calibration. We have our own accredited calibration lab in Bangalore, which is being maintained by Tektronix. We are also providing our warranty services support from the same region. So if you can see on your screen, we had our training setup in Bangalore. So this is the Fluke Center of Excellence, which we have inbuilt in our own office just to cater all these training requirements. So we have our Center of Excellence in Bangalore office, where we conduct regular trainings and all these kind of webinars inside our office. Now, with this introduction to Fluke, with this basic introduction, now let's move on and learn about electrical calibration. Now, I would invite Shaila Madam to come and take us forward with this journey for electrical calibration. Shaila Madam, over to you.
Thank you, Kaushik. I am audible.
You are audible, ma'am.
I think you can see my desktop presentation.
It is coming up.
Yes, yeah. We can see map your presentation. We thought there was a technical glitch in the beginning, so of course you've taken over. This is DCOM here once again. And
thank you so much, sir. Thank you very much.
But we can see your presentation very clearly. So will you take over at the moment?
Yeah.
Good morning, everybody.
Yep. Good morning, everybody. So it is my great pleasure to interact with you all. I am Shaila here. So today, definitely, as we discussed in the introductory lecture, so the measurement is a very important aspect of any field, including our day-to-day life. So the precision, reproducibility, what we were talking. So definitely, it is a center of today's society. So the measurements and the metrology. So we will be discussing today on basics of metrology and the significance of measurements, and also what is calibration. So how it is affecting, and also its relevance in our technical education sector. So definitely today's students are tomorrow's professionals. So after completion of your educational assignments, so you will be definitely connecting with your, taking your professional career. You are either going to connecting with some industries, or maybe a defense, or maybe a university research. So definitely it is challenging that you have to face the challenge of your connect with the industries as a tomorrow's professionals. So definitely measurement is going to take a very important role for connecting to the industries. So definitely it is a part of your future to understand, because today's syllabus as an academician, you will actually read as per the syllabus, and definitely there is a need to connect practically. So how this to actually help? This will help you to connect to the industries and tomorrow's professional career, and you can face the challenge in a better ways. So that is the just background of that. So definitely the importance of significance of measurement is very, very important. Why it is important? So before going that today's agenda, just I will just take to you the Fluke calibration platform. So the various fields already given by the Kaushik, but the accuracy, precision, reproducibility, what we talk. So how the Fluke calibration products are there. I'll just take 2 minutes for that. Then we will go to the today's subject, the significance of measurement and importance of calibration. So we see what is calibration and how it is affecting our day-to-day life. And also we see the various test and measuring instruments for electrical measurements. So you may be practicing in your laboratory as a part of your academics. So you might have seen some of the instruments. We will discuss about that. And what is the today's need in educational sectors to have a academic excellence? And also we will see the standard laboratory practices, the basic metrology requirements. And also we see the Fluke initiatives for technical institutions for academic excellence. So we will see about that. And also we see some of the products which are used in the laboratories. So definitely as Fluke calibration is the platform which will give you the total solution for laboratory application. So we talk on precision, reproducibility, stability, accuracies, errors. So many things will come in metrology actually. So these things are assured by the precision meters or precision calibrators. So definitely you should have a very high accuracy, very stable, which can reproduce the results. So definitely you need a, that is called as the masters. So they are called as the calibrators, which will give you the very precision, precise, accurate, stable. Suppose you are using a, in your laboratory, you may be using a power supply. So it is also producing a 10 volts or 30 volts. So is it stable? What is the accuracy of that? How best it can give you? What is the stability of that? How it can reproduce? So that is the one that we have to study the behavior of the measurement, and definitely the stability and reproducibility, precision, all these comes into picture when we talk on the precision measurement. So we will see what is actually measurement. So when it comes to that, we talk about the calibrators, what we say that the masters that are used for calibration application. So these masters as a Fluke calibration segments, there are totally 6 platforms we give in electrical calibration, temperature calibration, pressure calibration, gas flow calibration, and RF calibrator up to 27 gigahertz, and also the unique software. Okay, and apart from that, the total integrated calibration solution, the customized solution for the calibration laboratories to practice as a calibration bench. The accuracy wise, right from the national laboratory, you can see the accuracy pyramid here. So the various accuracy levels. So we have echelon 1, echelon 2, echelon 3 as a accuracy level given by the metrologists, and it is practiced across globe. So when we talk about the highest accuracy of a primary standards, so that is practiced by the NMIs. They are called as the National Metrology Institutes. So NPL India is the National Metrology Institute for India. So right from the national laboratories, the accuracy flows from top to bottom. And for various applications, we may have the different kinds of masters to use depending upon the application. So the Fluke calibration has a big basket of the calibration masters to meet the different levels of accuracies, and definitely right from national lab to the instrumentation. So that is the definitely the big basket of products which can be configured to have the definitely the application of the various labs. So the today's topic, we go that significance of measurement. So definitely it is a very, very important aspect. Okay, so we see in day-to-day measurement what actually I practiced the metrology for 32 years. So it was told. What is actually as a metrologist means what? So metrology is nothing but a practicing. It is a metrology. So metrology is nothing but a measurement. So someone who practiced the measurement. So in the laboratory. Okay. So what is metrology? Metrology is nothing but a science of measurement. So it may be. It is applicable everywhere and anywhere, including our day-to-day life. You can see here. So suppose suppose I want to really know my weight. So just to give you very, very practical example, suppose I have put on a weight and I want to control my weight. So what you do? So you really weigh your body weight by weighing scale. So I have gone 110 kg. So definitely I have to control my weight. So you do the actually measurement with the weighing scale. Okay, so definitely as a part of that, suppose suppose I want to know the height of my body, so I weigh really measure with the steel scale. So definitely the measurement is something that we are quantifying something, okay, and it is applicable everywhere, and through measure only we can really control it. And measurement definitely comes from, suppose in day to day, suppose it is a manufacturing. So you are manufacturing the bolt and nut. So definitely the bolt and nuts goes when it is we have measured it and we have matched, and that comes through again the measurement. Okay, so we are measuring the diameter of the bolt, diameter of the bolt and nut, and they should match it. So that is called as the precision. So abhi aap plug mein dalte ho, so that should again match. So this all comes from the measurements. So if you don't have a measurement, definitely there is no, actually in the practical life, there is no, without measurement there is no move and there is no control. So definitely it's applicable anywhere and everywhere. Just for the example of you, that suppose you have a one manufacturing institution. So there are different phases of manufacturing, right? From design, then development, then after manufacturing it go to the quality control, then quality assurance. So these are the different phases of manufacturing. So definitely you in R&D again you measure it. So when you develop the protocol, then actually it go to the manufacturing when it is passes. So these phases definitely has the measurement. So quality control, I have a specification, suppose it is a 0.5 plus minus 0.2. So it should meet that tolerance. So that comes from again your measurement. So once the QC passed, then only it goes to the quality assurance. So definitely is the measurement is a part of everyday life, and definitely it is going to what actually is measurement is, we are quantifying something, any physical quantity. So measurement is nothing but the operation where we are actually quantifying some quantity of the physical item. It may be a ampere, it may be a current, it may be a length, it may be a weight, or it may be a diameter of a ball, anything. So we are quantifying some physical quantity, that is called as the measurement. So measurement is the first step. Suppose in today's scenario, so the entire world is hit with the COVID. So we are really detecting in airport, you go to the railway station, you go to the bus stands. So every person is really screened with a IR thermometer. So it is measuring the बॉडी टेम्परेचर. सो 100 डिग्री से ऊपर होता है तो देन इट इज डायग्नोज दैट दे हैव टू कंट्रोल द कोविड. सो इट इज अफेक्टेड. सो डेफिनेटली डिटेक्ट्स द बॉडी टेम्परेचर. सो इट इज ऑल्सो एग्जाम्पल ऑफ. सो डेफिनेटली द मेजरमेंट इज द फर्स्ट स्टेप दैट लीड्स टू इम्प्रूवमेंट. नाउ यू अंडरस्टूड, एंड इफ यू कॉन्ट अंडरस्टैंड, इफ यू कॉन्ट मेजर इट समथिंग, यू कैनॉट अंडरस्टैंड इट, एंड इफ यू कॉन्ट अंडरस्टैंड इट, यू कैनॉट कंट्रोल इट. And if you cannot control it, you cannot improve it. So definitely measurement is the first step that leads to the improvement, and that builds you the quality in your products. And calibration also is nothing but a measurement. So now we connect the measurement with the calibration. So calibration also is nothing but a measurement. Of course, it has two basic requirements what we will be discussing, the test uncertainty ratio and the traceability. Okay, so now we understand what is measurement. So what is calibration? So calibration is something that we are actually comparing the performance of a testing measuring instruments. Okay, maybe a ammeter, or maybe a panel meter, or maybe a clamp meter, what you are using in the laboratory, whether it is perfectly working as per the required specification given by the manufacturer. That is very, very important. Each measurement has its own objective. So whatever I am measuring should be correct, then only whatever objective I am meeting. Suppose I am measuring at 10 volts and my requirement is 10.5 10 volts plus minus 0.2 volts. But if it is really measuring 11 volts, so can you really meet the requirements? So that is what is calibration. So calibration is nothing but we are verifying the operational integrity and the performance of the test under calibration. That is called as the device under calibration with a master of very high accuracy, which can give you the very accurate signal, very accurate, precise, repeatable, stable signal to compare and also detect and also correct any deviation from its required performance. So the required performance is nothing but a specification of equipment. That's what is the calibration. So we are definitely comparing with the standard, okay, which is very high accuracy. And as per the requirement of calibration, so the master what we use should be at least 4 times in our time. When I joined in 1982, it was a golden rule. So it should be at least 10 times better than our device under calibration. But as the today's market, we are getting more accurate instruments day to day in the market. The latest guideline says the uncertainty has to be at least 4:1. So the master should be at least 4 times better than the device under calibration. So it is, that is the major requirement of regulatory standards. And also the traceability is of course is a very important aspect of measurement in a metrology. So your whatever measurement should be traceable. So traceability is nothing but a unbroken chain of measurement stretching back to national or international standards. So as I discussed the NMI, so it should be traceable to the national standard, that is the NPL New Delhi, or it may be an international standard. So suppose if it, you have got the calibration certificate from Fluke, so definitely that is an international calibration. So that is called as the traceability. And definitely as a required valid calibration, so the accepted levels test uncertainty as per the guidelines. So you might have heard the NABL 129. So that is nothing but a national accreditation board for testing and calibration. So the 17025 is the global standard as per that. So the minimum TUR should be 1:4. So definitely now, as you know, the importance of calibration. So definitely you know that it builds you the confidence in the measurement, and really it definitely give you the confidence that whatever I am doing is right. And the routine calibration is nothing but a health checkup of equipment. So as you go every year, you go for a body checkup, you check the parameter of our body so that we are healthy. So just like that, the periodic calibration of equipment is nothing but a health checkup of a product. So periodic calibration has to be done to see that it is perfectly working and it gives you the reliable results, which ultimately feed you the quality in the products whatever you using. So definitely the measurement and calibration is a very, very important to build a quality in the products and also a services. So definitely it is a now you know that how important it is, measurement. So whenever you see the in your laboratories, so you might have seen that you are using a oscilloscopes, you might have used a panel meter, you might have used a clamp meter. So very, very different types of electrical equipments what we use. Okay, so these are the instruments what we use, maybe a 3.5 digital meter, maybe clamp meter, panel meters, watt meters, power harmonic analyzers, meggers, for various applications. So definitely we measure the various electrical parameters. What all the electrical parameters we measure? So you may be a instrumentation engineer. So you have a measurement as a control, as a one subject. So definitely you know the what all the instrumentation what we use. So what all the parameter what we use? It may be a DC voltage, AC voltage, DC current, AC current, resistance. So all these electrical parameters definitely has to be measured. And so definitely when it comes to the technical education sector like you, so definitely the main activity of any formal technical program is to train the students as per the scheme and syllabus. Definitely I understand. So definitely when it comes to the career, as I told you that the understanding of the measurement is very, very important. Okay. And it gives you the self-sufficiency as a whole to the society. Okay, so any technical institution to have academic excellence, so there is a called as a NBA accreditation. So your colleges or universities accredited as per the NBA guideline, that you know, as per the university research accreditation. So, and as the excellence in academics, so definitely it is very important to have a well-equipped laboratories, sophisticated libraries, highly qualified and experienced faculties, and also the staff members, well-designed campus. So definitely these are very, very important for the success of any university. So when we talk of the well-equipped laboratories, okay, so it will help you to shape up the technical competency of the students to meet the technological challenge that gives you the practical exposure, and that will give you the practical approach. So presently many private and government technical institutions, of course Fluke is very, very connected with the industries, and right from I told you the pyramid. So it is in all field of these industries, and also the laboratories, the defense, the this one, and also the university research. Okay, so definitely it is very, very important that the today's measurement and metrology has taken a very important role, as I told you, including the aerospace and defense. We talk space. So space, definitely in any field, it is the zero tolerance we talk. So zero tolerance comes from your measurement. So because when we are really launching some space craft, so definitely it has to work and over a period of time. So it comes from again measurement. So it may be a defense, anything. You take a research, you take a university research, or a healthcare, or a refineries, industries, utilities, railways, anything you go. So definitely this has taken a very major role, and whatever they come, definitely the measurement has taken the important role, and the definitely the connection of today's students as a metrology, because we talk of software, so I know the software, this definitely, but calibration and metrology definitely is a very, very important thing to be need of our to make that these will be really a part of our academics, and definitely the practicing the measurement give you the bigger exposure and also to the industrial connection. So the today's students metrology has gained, as I told you, and definitely it is very important that they should be exposed to the practical laboratories measurement, and for the faculty also they can even improve the their knowledge on the metrology with the laboratory kind of thing, and even for the accreditation and for the management, definitely it improves the quality of education for any university research, and also it require as a guidelines for requirement of NBA accreditation. So when we talk the Fluke initiatives, so we have established many kind of center of excellence in a metrology and connect with the industries and the academics, and we have lot of presence in the electrical and the temperature and pressure as an integrated solution, and also we skill development center also is one of the initiative which will really gain you the kind of industrial exposure to the students, and have a laboratory and have a hands-on workshop with a laboratory hands-on, and also we can have a workshop and seminars in the special field of metrology measurements, power quality, smart grid applications, many fields depending upon the actual application. So definitely we have installed many laboratories of center of excellence, and also the skill development centers. Some of them are in NIT Trichy, IIT Madras, then IIT Kanpur. Many, I am not going to take much on this. So definitely it is the measurement and the laboratories of center of excellence in metrology is a very today's need to have the more important exposure to the students. And these are some of the institutions definitely that we have installed the laboratories and excellence, Manipal Academy, then PSG, then KCT, NIT, Calicut. So So these are the some of the laboratories. So definitely when we talk on this calibration, of course I don't have a much time to go, because in 2 hours definitely completing this measurement, of course we can have a separate session for even the metrology things. And as a laboratory we will talk on some of the important requirements for electrical calibration. So definitely the electrical calibration works on, because the performance of these, repeatability and reproducibility or a precision accuracy, everything depends on these parameters given by the calibrators. And 230 volts, these are the some of the location requirements for the laboratories. So the power supply is very, very important. Okay. And also the temperature and humidity has to be maintained in the laboratory as per the regulatory requirement. And these are some of the products what are used in the laboratory, maybe a multi-product calibrator, which is really sourcing those parameters, what we talk DC voltage, AC voltage, AC current, all these electrical parameters. And there are some measuring standards, they are called as the measurement standard. So it may be a 6.5 or 8.5 digit meters. So as an electrical portfolio, we have a big chunk of equipments, maybe a multi-product calibrators and a 6.5 digit meter, three-phase power calibrator, oscilloscope calibration, Megger calibrators. So we talk of multi-product calibrators. So it is actually a sourcing calibrator, which will give you the best accuracy of 11 ppm, and definitely it can calibrate a very big workload of the laboratory requirement. And the precision meters, 6.5 and 8.5 digit meters, and the RF calibrators up to 27 gigahertz, and high precision calibrators, and the three-phase power calibrators, okay, to calibrate your power analyzers, because power quality is very, very important. You talk about three phase, you talk about the transients, you talk about the harmonics. All these things are very, very important. So you get a precise signal for calibration of these power quality parameters with the three phase power analyzers. And also we have a specialty calibrator that is electrical calibrator, which will give you to calibrate the Meggers. Meggers and insulation testers you might have used. It gives you back voltage, the DC voltage, maybe 1000 volts, 500 volts, 2500 volts, 500, 5 kV. So to calibrate this kind of things, we have a special calibrator. So when we talk of a multi-product calibrator, so definitely it gives you these signals, whatever we talk, the electrical signal. And as Kaushik told, they are the most safe. So with the input protection, the safety is maintained. Okay. And it gives you all those signals to meet the TOR requirement to have a really calibration of very big chunk of products. Okay. And it also has the scope option, and which can calibrate even oscilloscopes. So it, apart from this all handheld meters, voltmeter, ammeter, and up to 6.5 digital multimeters, and also the current clamp meters, so with this current coil, and process calibration, data loggers, so everything it can calibrate, including a 1.1 oscilloscopes. So the oscilloscope with 1.1 gigahertz. So, and you will also get accessories. So this is a reference meter. What we talk as a laboratory standard, which will really measure. So it is a measurement standard. It is a 8.5 digit meter, the Fluke 8558 and 8588. So these are the application is to measure these signals. Okay. Very, very with the best accuracy of 2.7 ppm. So this is the best measuring capability across the globe. It is a Fluke 8588, which will calibrate which will measure these 12 parameters. So the DC voltage, AC voltage, DC current, AC current, and also it has a 4 instruments inside. It can also, suppose you have a function generator or a waveform generator or any meter, so it can be calibrated using this frequency counter. It has an inbuilt frequency counter, and also it has a thermometer capability, and also it has a capacitance capability, measurement capability, and also it can work up to RF up to 40 gigahertz. Okay, so that definitely I will not go in much detail about the product. So definitely these are some of the products I wanted to discuss. And so this is the calibration requirement for any as a center of excellence. So you need to mention have a laboratories with a very very high precision standards to really source and also the sense and the with automated automation in the lab. So as I told you, the METTIM is the calibration management software which will really automate the entire workload. Okay, to give you the improved productivity and performance controlled consistent test reports, comply with all the standards, eliminate the errors as it is automatic. So with this, I think I close my session. So we can take a question answer at the end or now. It's okay.
Yes, ma'am. Sure.
I give it to Nathji. So you can take up this.
Yes, sir. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, very much. Your screen visible.
Right. So thank you, madam. Thank you, the organizers. I'm actually feeling at home because I belong to Northeast. Right. Before I moved on to Delhi for professional requirement. Actually, I have spent over 30 years in the industry, various disciplines, and out of that, 19 years in Fluke. Fluke also having this pressure and temperature schools they conduct in US factories, and I spent considerable time there. So I am basically that way graduated from the Fluke temperature and pressure school. So there's this famous quote by Lord Kelvin, who is the father of modern thermodynamics. When you measure what you are speaking about and express it in numbers, you know something about it. But when you cannot express it in numbers, your knowledge about it is of a meager and unsatisfactory kind. I mean, case of temperature, the sensing element is actually the transducer which is converting temperature into a kind of a measurable format that can be resistance or can be voltage. So in the temperature measurement system, the largest contribution of error comes from the sensing element. So probe conformity or the accuracy, that itself is one of the biggest source of error. Like for the industrial RTD DIN class, for the class A RTD also, the accuracy specification is 0.15 degree centigrade. And this errors are worse as we go up in the temperature, in the higher the temperature. These probes or the sensors, they drift over time as well as the fuses. Now RTD, that changes due to the vibration, shock, and the temperature exposure. The thermocouple, they lose some of the material and also get oxidized due to exposure. So what is the countermeasure? So the calibration is the only way to see and correct those errors. Now, my previous speaker talked about that requirement of the TAR or TUR requirement. So here is the example, one practical example to show you that one. Suppose I am using a 4 times more accurate standards. So that means my TAR is 4:1. So when I'm using that one, so instrument is calibrated, that error actually is transmitted to the unit I'm calibrating is 125%. That means 100% is coming from the UT specs and 25% is coming from the standard. Similarly, if I use more accurate standard, that is 10 times more, in that measurement error I'm transferring is 110%. So if you can see in the figure here, if I reduce the error, in that case, we are able to extend the recalibration period. So if I am using the higher accuracy standard, so then maybe instead of 1 year, maybe you can extend your recalibration, annual recalibration into the 2 year or that regular health check so that you can avoid that one. To get more peace of mind for an extended period of time. The common temperature sensor is a platinum resistance thermometer. From the name itself, you can understand it is that resistance. The when temperature is changing, it is converting into the resistance. In the same class, the thermistor also does the same thing. And also, there is a thermocouple thermometers, which actually converting temperature into the voltage form. So platinum resistance thermometers are commonly, it is known as RTD. Sometimes people call it PT100. So this is available very, you know, different accuracy class. Also, it is available for a very wide temperature range, minus 200 to 1000 degrees centigrade. It is very popularly used in the industry. So these are basically made of high purity or doped platinum wire. Many times it is wire wound on a ceramic support, or it can be thin film construction. So it gives a very low sensitivity, but it's very stable over time, the temperature, and also it is available with various size and shapes and the configuration. Thermistors is also very accurate, is available very high accuracy, but it is only available for a very narrow temperature range, 0 to 100 degree. So these are basically made of semiconductor material and also available bead or disc construction, and the high sensitivity also is a negative temperature coefficient. These are also sufficiently stable over the time and temperature. So this is showing you that the fact that case of PRT, as the temperature increases, the resistance increases, whereas in case of thermistor, it's a negative coefficient. As the temperature increases, the resistance decreases. Thermocouples is also very popular in the industry. It's generally available in low to medium accuracy, but extremely high temperature it covers, high and low as well, from minus 200 to 1700. Even it's constructed from a two dissimilar metals, and it produces the voltage when the two different joints, the ends are exposed to temperature difference. It is available in a bare or probe type configuration. It also has a really low sensitivity, and it is relatively very less stable over the time. So calibration, as I described, is a comparison. It's a comparison versus known and unknown. So for a temperature calibration, what do we need? We need a known temperature source, means the temperature source where we can set the temperature with a good accuracy and the known temperature. Like here, what we have done, we have taken out as example is a one dry block calibrator, which is a temperature source, and we can set the temperature inside a dry block. If we set that 50 degree, and then both the external reference thermometer and the sensor we are going to calibrate, which is called the UT and the readout, we are both are exposed to the or inserted into the dry block, and we note down the temperature of both the external as well as the UT, and that the difference is the error associated with the other UAT. So for temperature calibration, there are three PRTs basically. So you need to select one good reference standard that can be PRT or SPRT or the thermistor or the thermocouple. There are various categories, various accuracy level available, and you have to select accordingly. As we talked about that, what you need is a four times accurate or something, accordingly you have to, you know, take a call. Then you have to take a, you have to select a temperature source. Here also we have plenty of variants available. Some goes very low temperature, minus 95. Some goes even very high temperature, 1200, even more. Some are liquid filled, some are water filled, some are dry heated. There is no any liquid inside. It is electrical heated. So you have to select according to your application or the sensor range basically, because you have to calibrate both the minimum point of the sensor and the maximum point of the sensor. And finally, you need one of the display device readouts, because the sensor's output is in the electrical form, either in the temperature or the resistance, or the voltage. So you need to convert this into the temperature scale. So this devices has got that kind of a mathematics or the algorithm which built in and ability to convert into that degree centigrade or Fahrenheit, and gives that convenience to the user so that it can easily compare. When it comes to that reference platinum resistance thermometer, so traditionally we know that one. So it is, we make a characterization of that platinum resistivity using a calendar van Duchenne equation, or we call it a CVD equation. RT is equal to R0 into 1 plus alpha T. We know about it, where alpha is that thermal expansion coefficient. And this thermal expansion coefficient alpha is defining the purity and the quality of the platinum as well as the your reference sensor. If that quality of or the alpha value is 3.925 into 10 to the minus 3, so then it is high quality and it can be used as a reference. Whereas the industrial one, typically it is 3.85 into 10 to the minus 3, or we call it commonly PT385, that is the kind of thing. So the important is that when you are selecting any reference PRT, so that should you should look at that the alpha values, it should be that 0.003925. And also it should have that ITS 90 interpolation formula. That's the call it international temperature scale used in the temperature. And it is calibrated as per that international guideline, because that CBD, what I just mentioned, that is more associated with the industrial one. But when it comes to the reference PRT, it is that you have to follow that international guideline, and it is interpolation, or that it is characterized according to ITS 90 formula. So dry block, I just mentioned, dry block is nothing but there's a metal block and that heater elements are wrapped over it. And we are heating this one, creating a uniform or isothermal temperature zone. And that the metal block is used for the heat transfer basically. And there are a lot of holes or drills are inside. And these drills, we are inserting that the sensors, what we are going to calibrate within that holes. So these holes are also available at different size because it has to be proper fit. So dry blocks are generally moderately accurate, but it's very popular because it is quite, you know, fast to change the temperature, because the typical calibration environment, you have to do 5.6 point, you have to go from low point temperature, high temperature. So what you want to finish in a quicker time. So you need something which can settle down one temperature to another temperature in a quick time. So it is a dry, because if it is a liquid, then I know it becomes very heavy and then cleaning comes into the picture. So it's a dry and clean. Also, it is the portable because many of these calibration requirements at the site level. So you can carry to the site. So all the holes, inserts had some fixed hole, but then you can have a multiple insert with the different holes. And also this has got a fixed immersion depth and there's an internal reference probe is there for controlling the temperature and providing a stable temperature. The last thing what you need is a thermometer. Ideally, you should look for a multi-channel because at least you need two, one for the reference, one for the sensor you are going to calibrate. But if you want to calibrate multiple at a time, so of course, then you need a multi-channel capability. And also that universal input in the sense, it should be able to read the voltage or the resistance. You might have different kind of sensor coming for the calibration. And the more another important is that it should have that sensor characterizations like ITS 90 or CVD, all those equations or the built inside. So this is the table inside. You have to select the table, and once you select the table, so it will convert the resistance and voltage into the temperature. So now moving on to the pressure. So pressure is also important for many industries, you know, like the aerospace industries, the airspeed or the height it is flying, it is all calculated based on the pressure difference. For predicting the weather, you need a barometer. In hospitals, oxygen provides that life support. In a oil and gas, where the downhole and the downhole systems require a very precise calibration, pressure calibration, gas metering, in the steam industry, so many places. So it becomes it's a very, and also application is a very wide. So pressure is a derived parameter, and it uses three base quantities defined in the SI unit, that's the mass, length, and time. It is a kind of a state variable, like the temperature, which you know shows the state of the physical state of the substance. And most temperature sensing devices like the gauge, they are used for a very wide pressure range. The measurements are made, you know, when we are pressurizing. So that pressure medium we use, sometimes it is a gas medium, or sometimes it is a hydraulic medium. When it is a gas, we use the nitrogen or air. When it is a hydraulic, we use something oil or water. So this is, if we want to, you know, place this pressure application on a scale basis, So there are many application comes in the vacuum side. Those basically the pneumatic calibration. In the pneumatic calibration, is the atmospheric or the barometer calibration? That also pneumatic calibration. Airspeed used by the avionics industries. That's something around 350 kPa. So that pneumatic calibration ends at something called something at 100 megapascal or 1000 bar. So pneumatic calibration is not available or not possible. There is no standard available which can go beyond that one. So whereas hydraulic starts from the zero gauge or the atmospheric pressure, you cannot go to the negative or the vacuum using hydraulic pressure. So hydraulic starts from the zero gauge, which is, again, we call it the gauge pressure, but it can go up to very, very high pressures. So how a pressure is created in a closed container, if we keep some fluid, is a gas, so then the gas molecules are hitting the walls. The pressure at the side of the wall is the average impulses over this area. So if there is no molecule, so then it's a zero pressure, absolutely no molecule there. And if we measure something starting from the zero pressure, then we call the absolute pressure. And this barometric pressure is an example of that as atmospheric pressure. But if we measure something with respect to the atmospheric pressure, the blue line depicts here is the atmospheric pressure. If you can see that one, that is very dynamic. So if you measure something with respect to the atmospheric pressure, so in the positive side, we call a positive gauge. If you go into the below atmospheric pressure, then we call the negative gauge pressure. But nevertheless, we cannot go below in the negative side below the atmospheric pressure. The differential pressure, it is the difference between two pressure, can be anywhere between in the pressure scale. And if it is close to that atmospheric pressure, we give another special name, which is called the drop pressure. This is one important assumption of the theory for the pressure calibration. That's the Pascal's principle. What it states that in a closed container, fluid at rest, so if pressure changes, it is applied to one part of the container and it is transmitted equally to all parts of the container. And the pressure metrologist, they use this hypothesis or this theory, so and they compare the instrument, putting the reference at the one side and the UT in the another side. So the gas media, so they have some advantages, some disadvantage as well. You can be used up to 100 megapascal, but it not possible in the go to much higher side one because it is very dangerous because it stores a lot of energy. So there's a safety issue if you go very high in pneumatic. That's why it is limited up to 1000 megapascal. But the advantage is that it never contaminates the device you are going to calibrate. So normally what you use, anything that nitrogen cylinder bottle or air bottle, that can give up to 200 megapascal or 200 bar. But if you want to go beyond that one, you need something kind of a gas booster. So gas is a compressible. So as it go to the higher pressure, so we are compressing the gas. So density also changes according. So again, density is never a fixed. If you want to have some kind of a density consideration in terms of the applying the height correction, so that's the kind of thing you have to see, that density is never fixed in case of gas calibration. Air and nitrogen are the most common for a gas calibration as a medium. The liquid medium, so it cannot be used below atmospheric pressure. So it's not water, because it doesn't provide the good lubrication unless otherwise something requires a cleaning issue. Otherwise, we use the oil. It is not very dangerous and you can easily generate very high pressure. It is not it is incompressible. So with a little bit of pressurize, we can generate very high pressure. So, and also density is always close to one. Some of the silicon oils are very viscous, very thick and heavy, so then you cannot use that one because that will not flow properly from one, and impulse cannot travel from one side to another side. So it comes to the pressure unit. The SI unit of the pressure is the Pascal, and that is named after the French mathematician Basile Pascal. So it is a Newton per square meter. So 1 Pascal is equal to 1 kg meter per second square. So basically it kind of a 100 grams, the pressure spreaded so that 1 square meter and underneath is the 1 pascal. So you can understand it's a very, very small pressure, 1 pascal, because atmospheric pressure, what we are always, you know, surviving or sustaining every time, it is 1 lakh pascal. So that's why more commonly we use kilopascal or megapascal. Unfortunately, there are many non-SI units are used for practical purpose, like the PSI or inch of mercury, inch of water, or the bar. So that makes it a little bit of confusing. But for a research community, they always, or the calibration laboratories, they're now all switching over to the SI units as a kilopascal or the megapascal. Sometimes you will see somebody is assigning after the pressure unit A or G. So A stands for that they are referring to that absolute pressure. If is there's a G is there, so they that is assigned to that gauge pressure. So some of the schematics are strategy for handling the pneumatic calibration. So what do we need? We need a supply bottle, and then it is connected to a supply valve. So in this case, supply valve, what you need is a metering valve. That metering valve should have the ability to generate the flow and control the gas through the bottle and set the pressure within the device and the reference. Both are connected in a single line in series. And also a good idea to have a variable volume, and which can give you a very fine adjustment. And then at the end, you connect a vent valve. And if you want something kind of below atmospheric pressure, you need to connect a vacuum pump at the vent valve. So putting the vent valve at the end also gives some kind of advantage, because in this case, the gas is always traveling from left to right, that is from reference, the DUT, and going to the atmosphere. So if the gas bottle has some kind of a contamination, so it is going to the reference first, then going to the DUT, and then thrown to the atmosphere, because the devices which comes to the calibration, many times it has got a lot of contaminations inside. So if there is a backflow, then it can contaminate the system, contaminate the reference. So this is one of the good way to handle a contamination issue, even for a simple pneumatic calibration setup. So hydraulic calibration, here there's the additional the reservoir, oil reservoir is there. So from the oil reservoir, it goes to the pneumatic, the priming pump first, because it is a closed system. There can be a trapped air, and there's a supply valve. In this case, it's just on and off valve. So we on and then allow this priming pump to flush the air first, and then use this variable volume to push the oil inside, and then going to the reference as well as the DUT. And once we release the pressure, it goes through the vent valve back to the reservoir. So that means there are different types of pressure calibrators available. The pressure pump and the comparator, the deadweight tester, and the pressure controller calibrator. But one thing is challenging, makes the pressure calibration challenging, is that pressure is never stable. Because we know from kinetic theory of gases, PV is equal to NRT. So pressure is a variable of volume, temperature, and the amount of the gas inside. So if the volume changes, like that, screw pump is pushing the oil, so changing the volume, so the pressure changes. If there is any leak where some of the trapped, some of the fluid inside is losing, so then pressure will change. So when you are compressing the fluid, the temperature is going up, the pressure will going to change. So it is always a challenge how we can stabilize the pressure, because unless we have that stable pressure, we'll not able to make that good and precise measurement. The pressure pump and comparator, which is a very common and very popular and the most economic solution, what you are using, here just a screw pump kind of thing. So but moment we give some kind of a torque or a turn to the screw pump, and after that the volume becomes a fixed. We are not changing the volume. And as volume the fixed, so the temperature changes. So temperature will happen. What will happen after some time, temperature will come to come back to the original or the ambient temperature. So we'll see that consistent the pressure is dropping, and you will feel, and you will not able to make a proper measurement. So what you can do, maybe you can again give another kind of another stroke and bring the temperature. So if you do this repeatedly, probably that decay in pressure will be much less, the rate of decay will be much lesser, but then it will be never stable. The deadweight tester, which is the primary standard, it is around for industry for over a century. it works on that primary principle, the pressure is equal to force over the area. But the pressure is correct only when the piston is in the floating condition. So the dead weight tester is also called a floating piston dead weight tester. So what we do, we have some kind of a, again, the screw pump something, which pressurize at the bottom and piston floats, and then we put some counterweight and both, so the it floats at one single pressure. So we know that pressure, what is the pressure inside that inside that dead weight tester. Now the primary benefit of a dead weight tester versus comparator, there's a no adjustment. When there is no adjustment, like the screw pump, I've just kept at one place, I'm not changing the volume. So comparator is a fixed volume. So in a closed system, as you have seen that one, if it's a closed system, fixed volume, as the temperature changes, the pressure changes. And that change is much more pronounced in the liquid system as compared to the gas system. But the dead weight tester is not a fixed volume. The piston always floating and moving up and down to compensate the temperature changes or any other changes. So as long as the piston is the floating, the pressure is stable and the pressure is correct. So the floating piston is acts as a very stable kind of the regulator, we call it a self-tuner. Now comes the latest, is that pressure controller calibrator. It is also now slowly replacing the dead weight testers. So it is a complete product, gives the complete solutions. It overcomes some of the disadvantages of the dead weight testers as well. So it controls the pressure. So the pressure will be always stable. And also it will measure the pressure very accurately. And it does by allowing some kind of a dynamically set valves inside, allowing that air come or go outside. So it can set the pressure, it can control the pressure, and it can do with a very high degree of accuracy. Also, it can add the automation. So all the boxes are ticked when you have the pressure controller at your laboratory. So there are so many solutions available. So the question is that, which one is the right? How I can select the pressure calibrator? So there are a few questions you have to ask yourself before you select the solution, the calibrator. Whether what you want to do, you want to measure a gauge or absolute pressure? And what is the pressure range? What is the TAR or TUR you wanted to achieve? Whether you want to add automation or not? So here, this gives you in one slide the idea. So if it's a gauge pressure, yes, comparator, dead weight tester, everything can do it. But when it comes to the absolute pressure, neither comparator or dead weight tester can handle the absolute pressure measurement or calibration. So it is that controller which is required. Accuracy wise, comparator is of course the lowest accuracy at the bottom. Dead weight tester, based on it is available medium to very high also, based on the budget capability. And controller also, it is available again from medium to high. Stability, comparator will never give you the stable output, but yes, the dead weight tester and controller both will give the stable output. And the local gravity correction. Here, the dead weight tester requires a local gravity correction. It apparently looks very accurate, but then unless otherwise you apply the local gravity correction, local acceleration due to the gravity, so dead weight tester is not a very accurate device. But this is not required for a controller or the in the operator. The resolution also, the dead weight tester has got some limited resolution, whereas controller you can achieve very high resolution. And lastly, the automation, because being a digital device, you can make it a completely operator free operation from remotely. So to end with, I will give some tips for a good measurement practices. So if you are working with the pressure, and if you find the pressure is not stable, the very first thing you have to look at that the leaks. You have to manage the leaks first. And next is that safety. The pressure can be very dangerous if you're working high pressure. Always use the proper rated hoses and you check that one, rather doubly check that one. The uncertainty, you have checked that what is you wanted to achieve, 4:1 or more. Stability, so there is a general rule is that a pressure stability should be 10 times less than the test device uncertainty when taking a reading. So you follow that one and then probably that's good to go. Head correction, because as we learned that one, pressure is equal at the equal height. So So that means if both the reference as well as the calibrator is not at the same height, that can add to some kind of a error. And in case of a hydraulic, the low pressure, that can be very significant. So it is, you try to make both at the same level as far as possible. And also you try to make it the automation, because automation can helps you to, you know, manual recording, you know, you can also manual interference. So automation always helps to achieve that consistency and the repeatability. So if you are using the deadweight tester, always be careful the correcting the applying the local gravity correction. So the analog gauge, there is a bourdon tube inside C shape. That's typically the biggest workload still available in the industry. So if you are using some oil to clean it, so since it is a kind of capillary and the C shaped, if you release the pressure, generally the oil is never come back completely. Some oil will be inside, so you have to clean it always after the calibration. You inject some oil cleaning fluid and then shake it a couple of times. Probably if still that is not good enough, you can use this kind of a syringe and with a narrow tubing, and that insert the tubing to the end of that bourdon tube and then push the cleaning reagents and then suck it again. So you can have, but you have to do this exercise a couple of times. So pressure, we calibrate for a over a period of time. So first thing, what once you, before calibrating, you should do some exercising, go to the maximum pressure, release, come back. So that serves the two purpose. If there is a leak, so that becomes more pronounced at the high pressure. So go to the high pressure, you know, check for the leaks, come back, and also it eases any kind of a trapped stress inside the bourdon tube. So then you set the zero once again, and then you go one point to another point, wait for the stability, take the measurement, go the up cycle, and then you reduce the pressure to the down cycle. Because once you do this complete one, then you are able to see the hysteresis, and this is one of the important specification for a pressure calibration particularly. So see the hysteresis. You want to study the repeatability, then you have to repeat this step once again for the, you know, second time also, or third time maybe. So thank you. Be safe, and remember you can always count on us to help.
Thank you, Satyajit, for your introduction on flow calibration and different temperatures. To feel some disturbance. Yeah, thank you. So since we saw this electrical temperature and pressure calibration on nutshell, I'll just tell you what is that integrated calibration solution within Fluke is doing to bring all these domains together and build a strong working environment for the associates. So I'll just brief you about the ICS inside Fluke. So ICS, which is called as the Integrated Calibration Solution, is a business unit within Fluke. So what we do is we provide this end-to-end solution for our clients. So we have set up a center of excellence in multiple universities across India. We also provide calibration and testing benches for industries. We provide electrical packages and testing packages. We also provide mobile calibration and testing systems for in-house calibration as well as on-site calibration. So what is a test bench? I would like to explain you a bit more about this test bench. You would have seen in your college environment or in your laboratories, you will be having the test benches where all these equipments will be mounted, and it will be you will be able to work it on a practical environment. So this test bench also is very similar to what you use it in your laboratory. There we provide all the accessories or all the peripherals which is required to operate a particular instrument. For example, if you want to calibrate any mechanical device like temperature transmitter or a pressure transmitter, or a torque calibration to be done, or a dimension calibration to be done, you can use this test bench for any of such calibration where all the equipment such as pressure calibrator, a temperature calibrator, or a torque calibration system can be incorporated within this test bench in a fully automatic way. So our colleague Mr. Satyajit Nath was explaining about the calibration on temperature and pressure, how it can be automated through a pressure controller. So the pressure controllers have been replaced by the conventional deadweight testers, which were in market for almost a century. So the similar way, these test benches are the latest state-of-the-art technologies, which has replaced all the conventional products by including the automation feature inside this particular thing. So with this test bench, what all can you do? So when you have only the products around you, the environment will not look clean. So with this test bench, you will have a clean environment and an organized environment where nothing can go wrong, and your turnaround time will also improve. Say if you want to study a particular system in a systematic way, it has to be on a particular way where it can be presented. So this test bench is there to improve the overall shop cleanliness and your presentation point of view also. So taking a bit more details about the test bench. So this test bench is completely customized. So this is not a particular product that can be going to this. So this is a complete customized workstation where we are customizing it as per the requirement of the customer. Say, for example, if a temperature calibration or a pressure calibration has to be done, we will incorporate the necessary pressure controller, the necessary temperature calibration bath. We'll also provide the necessary temperature probes that has to be fit inside the bench. And it can also be achieved with an automated calibration system also. So we'll see some of the installations which we have done in the upcoming slides. So Fluke, as a complete solution provider, what we do is we provide a rugged, reliable, and accurate testing instrument solution to our customer. So you are aware that our products meet the safety standards as per the requirement. We also provide a very rugged instrument that can be used for decades and decades. So the major products which we handle is in the domain of temperature, pressure, electrical, and also in the field testing equipment, or we call the hand tools in the industrial terms. So we have these innovative products like the pressure controllers and the temperature baths, which has replaced the conventional products like deadweight tester and multiple other products which is not in use in the current market. So we have more than 150 installation base across India in various segments, and education segment is one of the most important segment for us, because that's where we create the center of excellence with our test benches. We have also set up this particular installation base in non-education sector also, but mostly we concentrate on education sector for the test benches and the automation software packages. So these high quality test benches are specifically designed for an specific application. Recently, one of the college in South India has implemented the calibration benches in their academics, as well as they have set up a center of excellence, and they are also catering this particular service for their nearby industries. So that's how the application varies from a customer to customer. So we also provide a single platform software. What do you mean by single platform is the user interface will look very similar, and the database connectivity will also look very similar. So this software will interact with all the disciplines, say temperature, pressure, and electrical, and it can facilitate your calibration in a much easier and much faster way. So we have our own dedicated design engineering and technical as well as commercial team in our Bangalore office, and throughout India we have our sales support and service staffs who will be assisting the team in installing and providing the training part. So we also provide NABL consultancy. So there are a couple of colleges in South India who have already obtained the NABL status by applying to the particular agency. So we also provide that consultancy for those type of colleges. So I'll quickly take you through the calibration and asset management software. I saw a question on the chat whether the mechanical devices can be automated. Yes, sir, very much. This can be automated. So how we can automate is, for example, if you want to do a pressure transmitter calibration. So the pressure transmitter will take the input source as the actual pressure, and the output will be given in either a milliamps or in the form of the primary value, say HALT or foundation field bus or Profibus. So how it can be automated is the pressure controller, which is automated pressure controller, will be interacting with this particular software which you are seeing on the screen. So the software will prompt the controller to set at a particular set point. Say if you want to do a calibration of 1 to 10 bar for a particular transmitter in steps of 5 points, so the software will set the controller in the first point, say 1 bar, and at 1 bar, after the controller is stabilized, the transmitter output, which is there in milliamps, will be fetched automatically by the software. So the software will fetch means it will be read through a particular readout, let it be a high precise 6.5-digit multimeter or a particular data logger if the number of channels are more. So the milliamps or the primary value HALT will be read by that particular device, and it will be captured by the software. So the software will compute the value and it will give out the error. What is the difference between the source and the measure value? And the error should fall within the span or within the accuracy limit prescribed by the manufacturer of that particular mechanical instrument. So if that particular error is within the accuracy of the instrument, the software will give out the result as pass. If it is not within the limit, it will give out the result as fail. So you also have an option to trim that particular transmitter. For example, if a transmitter is out of specification or it is out of accuracy, there is a procedure to trim that particular transmitter to bring back it to the factory default settings. It can be zero trimmed, it can be trimmed to the upper value or to a lower value, or it can be also trimmed to the output value. So there are various trimming options available. And once it is trimmed, you will also do a post calibration just to ensure that your transmitter is working perfectly. So this is how a calibration is automated in a environment of the test bench. So mainly the software, calibration software, will have three aspects. So these are the very three key functions any software should have, actually. The first thing is an asset management software. Asset management module is nothing but a proper maintenance or a proper documentation of the device which is under test. So for example, if you have some of the devices which has to be tested, so we should keep a track of those devices. When it was calibrated previously, what is the next due date for the calibration, how frequently this is getting failed or this is getting drifted. So all these aspects are being maintained or monitored by the asset management module. So the asset management module will also give you periodic reminders on the due dates of the devices which is due for calibration, and it can also be got in your mail through automatic email push. So the second important key feature in the software is the actual calibration, which we just discussed before this slide. So the software will interface with the master instrument, which is the pressure controller, or let it be temperature controller, let it be torque calibration system, and it will also read feedback from the field instrument by measuring it through a high precise multimeter or a data logger. So that's how an automatic calibration is performed. So the third important thing is the reporting feature. So in any lab, whenever you're doing a particular calibration, reporting is the very, very important thing that has to be maintained in order to ensure that whatever you are calibrating is documented properly. So this reporting feature is very important so that your audits are taken care with those reportings. And any given point of time, if you want to refer a particular instrument's value, what was the previous calibration value, this reporting will help you a lot with giving you the precise data. So these are the sample screens of our software. This is a customized software, and it can be customized based on the master equipment which is being proposed or which is of the interest for the customer. So this is the welcome screen where the software levels will be given for the administrator or as well as the operator. This is a software which runs on a MySQL database, and we have collaborated this with National Instruments, who is the pioneer in LabVIEW software. So we have joined our hands with them for developing this software, and this is a customized software which has been developed for Indian markets. So this is the software screen. I'll not go in detail about these screens. So these screens are just to show you how the interface will be done. So there is a device configuration to enter the field instruments. There is a procedure configuration. So if you have some software engineers in your college, they can write their own procedures inside this, and they can develop their own procedure for the equipment. So this is a platform for creating such procedures. There is a master instrument configuration where you can enter the calibration data of the equipment, which is called the master or the calibrator level equipment. There is a user configuration, dual list viewer, and a database management system, event logger view, and the actual calibration screen and the report generation part. So this is the actual calibration screen. If you can see on the left-hand side of my screen, there are certain fields that has to be entered by the user before starting the test. So first he has to enter what is how many number of DUTs he wants to calibrate. And one more important thing is this is not limited. This automated software can handle multiple devices. For example, if it has to calibrate 10 sensors at a time, it can be incorporated automatically inside the system. So the user should enter the number of devices he has to calibrate. He has to select the order, increment, decrement, or both increment as well as decrement. He has to select what is the type of calibration has to be done and the procedure. So once these things are selected, the user can go ahead and start the test, and it will automatically source the data from the calibrator or the temperature system, and it will automatically read the DUT value from the measuring device. So with this, I'll just show you a few of our installations, prestigious installations, which is done in some of the colleges and institutions and various industries. So this is how a calibration bench or a test bench will look like. If you see on the left-hand side, those are the automatic pressure solutions which were available 10 or 12 years back. So that was our one of the first installations which we had done a decade ago in one of our engineering college in South India. And the right hand side, if you can see, is an electrical calibration bench. So there is a multi-product calibrator. You can see the multi-product calibrator. You can see a 6.5-digit multimeter. And there is also a PC which is mounted on the test bench to take care of the automation part and the reporting part. So we'll just see two more examples for temperature and pressure solutions similarly. If you can see on the left-hand side, there is an L-shaped calibration and test bench. So one part of the L-shape will take care of the temperature transmitter calibration, whereas the other part of the L-shape will be taking care of the temperature sensor calibration. So all these are mechanical devices, let it be temperature sensor or a pressure sensor or a torque system. So all these things can be fully automated using this particular system. The right side part, if you can see, is the pressure calibration bench where the pressure controllers are mounted. This particular controller will take care of the automation part along with the software which is mounted on the test bench. So this is one more important college, one very famous college in South India, Vellore Institute of Technology. So they had purchased these particular calibration systems, and they had also set up this center of excellence in their Vellore campus. So this is one of the college in South India, Kumaraguru College of Engineering, who has set up a center of excellence for temperature, pressure, and electrical. So they had three different cabins dedicated for each and every setup, and they applied for NABL status and they got it also. So our panelist Shaila ma'am, who is an expert in metrology, she had assisted this particular college in obtaining this particular NABL status for them. So now they are an accredited NABL lab for metrology and calibration. They are also providing catering their services for the nearby industries. So this is one of the multifunction calibration bench which was supplied for one of the college in eastern part. So this had all temperature, pressure, and electrical, and whatever is required for your academic as well as for the training purpose also. So with this, we have just come to the end of the presentation. We would like to take some of the questions if you have. Maybe you can unmute yourself and talk, or you can also post your questions on the chat.
Kaushik,
Yeah.
Thank you so much, Kaushik, for your presentation, along with the other experts in Madam Nadgir, Alan Nadgir, and very interesting to know as well that Mr. Nath, who's been from this part of the country, was also here with us today. Satyajit Nath, thank you so much for your presentations. We will have a few house rules on the questions. You interested participants can put in your questions onto that chat box, and we can take the questions from there. And in the meantime, for a moment, I can ask our colleague Hirok to also start off with the Q&A. And if there are anything else that you experts want to share at this moment,
actually, there was one question from the chat box. I could see that.
Yes.
There are two questions actually. How often it should be calibrated? Mm-hmm. So it's a very interesting question. So because the calibration depends on many factors actually. Now we know the process of calibration is nothing but the confidence we are comparing with a higher standard to see that whether it is performing as per the specifications. So we know that specification is something which is the written requirement of a manufacturer. So that depends again on the application. So definitely the calibration depends on many calibration periodicity depends on many factors. So how often it should be calibrated. So definitely there is no single rule. So definitely that depends on many factors. So it may be a mechanical wear and tear. So the frequency of use, if it is used every day, utilization the continuously 8 hours, or maybe a mechanical parts wear and tear like a vernier caliper, micrometers gauges or pressure gauges. So definitely that depends on the wear and tear. So that kind of instruments, if they are very often used, so even 3 months once also it can be calibrated. Suppose electronic equipment, so the components, there are a lot of components and there is tend to be a drift in the electronic components. So definitely the electrical instruments, generally the manufacturers say every 1 year it has to be calibrated. And suppose what is the condition you have used, how it is maintained, whether only the skilled person is using, what is the utilization hours. So it depends on many factors. So definitely it is important to know all these parameters and to maintain these under the strict environmental controls, and also the skilled manpower to be used. And if it is very often used and there is a subject to the wear and tear, definitely it has to be periodically calibrated very often, like depend upon 3 months like that. And also it depends on the application. So just like my example, suppose 3.5-digit meter, which is very low accurate, suppose it may be a 1% or 0.5% my mains power checking 230 volts. So that 3.5 meter is sufficient. But the same is when you come to R&D, where I need a very high precision repeatable measurements, I have to use a higher accurate equipment, maybe a 6.5-digit of 0.02%. So that depends on the application also. So the there is no single rule for calibration. So that depends on manufacturer specifications, plus the utilization, plus how it is maintained, and all these things, and also the application of the equipment. And also that depends on what is your quality department says as an industry. So that depends on many factors, and generally we calibrate these instruments depending upon these factors, and manufacturer specification is one of the very important requirement to fix up the periodicity. That is one thing I wanted to show. And one more question I had seen, that how these instruments are maintained to the accuracy. Suppose we know that accuracy is nothing but a specification of the equipment, how accurate, how best it can measure. Okay, if it is 1% means it should measure within 1%. So accuracy of the instrument is nothing but how best it can measure. Okay, so we are performing the periodical monitoring of these standards so that it works within the tolerance. You can see it is a control chart. Suppose my limit is plus minus 0.002 or 0.2. So I maintain this chart every depending upon your requirement to monitor this over a period of time and see that there is no drift and it is very stable. Then also I can increase my periodicity. That depends on the behavior of the performance of the equipment. So that is called as the control chart we maintain for our day-to-day performance verification of these standards. Okay, so that was one thing I wanted to share you. Yeah. Any other questions?
Thank you so much. We've been checking the list on the rack here. Although they say it's very informative, there was one question on mechanical instruments generally calibrate.
Yeah, mechanical calibration definitely, apart from electrical, all this pressure, temperature, flow, torque, and this mechanical instruments like vernier caliper or that kind of instruments. So definitely you should have a proper masters for that. Suppose if it is a length calibration using a micrometer, you have to use a very high precision slip gauge. They are called as the slip gauge. So they have a type of 00 grade or 0 grade. The precision measurement has to be done with the standards, as I told you, the very definition of a calibration, that you have to use a masters which are more accurate than our device under calibration. It may be any kind, mechanical instrument or electrical or temperature or pressure. So you have to have that kind of standards as a masters to compare your the performance of our drift parameter of your DUT. So generally for mechanical parameters, we use a slip gauge set or a vernier caliper checker or a temperature for this temperature gauges already Mr. Nath has discussed with you. We use various masters for that actually.
Great. Once again, thank you so very much for throwing us some insight on calibration and the finer details in this regard. I guess our Vice Chancellor, sir, is a little tied up on some other meeting at the moment, although he was supposed to join us towards the end. But nonetheless, for throwing all that lovely insight for this entire webinar on the basics of methodological and understanding importance of measurement and calibration concepts. I would once again like to thank all the experts, starting with Shaila S. Nagir, thank you so much, ma'am. She's the product manager of Electrical of Food Technologies Private Limited, Bangalore, along with our very own Satyajit Nath, who's spent about 19 years as a product manager with Fluke on pressure and temperature metrology. Thank you so much, Mr. Nath, for sharing the insight and also for letting us know that you're very much a part of the SAM. And finally, thank you so much, Kaushik Malachar, for throwing the insight in this webinar today. I once again, from the Royal Google University, would like to thank all the participants who joined us today for the webinar, along with the faculty of different organizations and students from various other institutions who joined us today for our webinar geared by Fluke Calibration. I hope we had a fantastic time throwing insights into this part of technology. Please kindly fill in the form, and for your certifications, our colleague Hirok has sent you all the link. Kindly fill the form and shoot it back to us. Once again, from Royal Google University and from the Innovation Cell, this is Nikom Bhuya wishing you all a very good afternoon, and please stay safe, stay healthy. Thank you and good afternoon.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Dekom. Thank you very much for this opportunity for sharing this insight.